Boston Scientific has reached a $188 million settlement nationwide over its phony marketing claims about certain surgical mesh products. These products were found to be totally unnecessary for most procedures and ended up causing extreme pain and bleeding among patients, absolutely permanent injury. I've got Robert Price with me, who's one of the lawyers that made all that happen, has been involved with the mesh case for a long time. Robert, tell us about this litigation, but fill us in about what this is about. What is the case about, why the settlement, and what's ahead of us?
Thanks for having me on, Mike. So the Boston Scientific settlement was a settlement about the pelvic mesh products, which were products that were implanted in women to treat incontinence and pelvic organ prolapse and things like that.
And you worked that case as well.
We've been working that case and many other manufacturers for over 10 years. And essentially, this was a settlement on behalf of AGs around the country that found that Boston Scientific had misled consumers, misled doctors about the true risks associated with the devices. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so give us a recap on what you're doing right now.
So what we're doing now is we see a lot of these same manufacturers did the pelvic meshes, also have done hernia meshes for many years, and it's the same byproduct. It's the same synthetic plastic polymer used to repair hernias, as well as the pelvic organ issues as we just talked about as well.
Well, you're talking about the material, but the thing that struck me is when you discovered that they were using non-medical grade material. Talk about, they're using fishing line, basically, that's sold in a fishing store. Talk about that.
Absolutely. It was uncovered in trials a few years ago, and what we're working up, the backstory, even deeper, what some companies do, not necessarily all of them, but several companies do this, is they use a non-medical grade byproduct. So literally just bottom shelf, not approved for human usage type stuff. It breaks down, it degrades.
It actually says not approved for human use, right?
The stuff that you get from the factory actually comes with a warning that says do not use this in the human body.
But they use it anyway.
They use it anyway. And what we're also discovering, Mike, is that they are coming up with different essentially shell companies to run this stuff through so people don't know any better. That's another thing.
Well, what do you mean by that? They're setting up shell companies. They're moving from the manufacturer of the material, mm-hmm. moving through a shell company, and then moving to the people who create the mesh product.
Right,
to try to wash the information.
Absolutely. Wow.
Okay, so as this goes forward, we're talking about a hernia mesh. What kind of injury does it cause? What should people be aware of?
So a lot of these products have these gimmicky coatings and things like that on them. And what we're seeing is the coating breaks down too soon. It doesn't work correctly. And these meshes actually, they adhere to people's organs. They'll blow out too soon. They'll fail. Catastrophic injuries like bowel punctures, internal bleeding, we said organ perforations.
Does the material migrate through their system after it blows out?
It can. It absolutely can. It can blow out, it can move over, and then you can have some of this chemical leaching that goes on with this really low-grade stuff, high inflammatory responses that cause gut problems and things like that as well.
Robert, one of the things that struck me is this is a procedure that's not even necessary because a doctor that's trained without mesh he can fix a hernia without any of this garbage, right?
A lot of times.
So industry came in and said, look, you need this because you're a doctor who's not a specialist in fixing hernias, but now you can increase your practice if you'll use our material. Isn't that kind of the scenario here?
That's right. We call them the gimmick meshes, which is they go to a doctor and say, yeah, you know, we know this hernia is real small and it would take you 20, 30, 40 minutes to do this, but it'll take you 5 minutes with this easy patch. They think, you know, the doctors a lot of time they think it's FDA approved. They think it's been studied when it really hasn't. And a lot of times it's unnecessary. Doctors don't need to do it, but it happens because they sold them a bill of goods, and it turned out the truth is unveiled many years later.
Actually, when you look at the pelvic mesh cases, the jury's jumped all over these companies, and these same companies, aren't
right,
they?
Right.
Robert, thank you for joining me, okay?
Thanks, Mike.
We've discussed on this show how PFAS toxins have made their way into our drinking water, and now we're seeing reports that these forever toxins are contaminating makeup products that are still being sold on store shelves. I have Sara Papantonio with me to talk about this product and this story. You've worked on this PFAS project for a while. You understand this case very well. When I saw this, that women are putting this on their face every day, that's absorbed through the skin, and regulatory is just like kicking the can down the road. What's your take on this story?
Right. And in order to understand the story, you got to understand just how potent of a toxin this is. PFAS is what we call the forever chemical. That's what we've labeled it in pop culture as. And what that means is that it's biopersistent. It stays in the blood. It's bioaccumulative. It accumulates the more you get. And it's bioactive. So it reacts with the organs. Mm-hmm. And so that's what these people are putting onto their eyes, their face, their makeup. And the skin is the largest organ in the body. It's absorbing it. And finally, we've got the courage and the commitment to do something about it. But the fact of the matter is, what this boils down to is we have known PFAS is dangerous for decades. And the FDA and regulators and government are just finally standing up and saying, okay, we'll take it out of your cosmetics.
Sara, I look at a case like this, the hesitation always seems to be they have political influence, okay? There's people at the top that are on boards, they're on government regulatory agencies. They stop it cold. You're familiar with the case tried up in the Ohio River Valley. They made a movie out of The Devil We Know. That was only the edge of the story. And still, we have regulatory dragging their feet on this product. How are these products used? Give me some examples of these cosmetics.
The fact of the matter is these are in every, PFAS is in everyday products. It's used to create water resistance. So it's in makeup, it's in waterproof eyeliner, eyeshadow, and all the, it's everywhere. And so like you said, the regulatory industry, what they're doing now is they're lifting their hands and saying, hey, look, we're gonna create legislation that takes this out of cosmetic products. But instead of being proactive, we're constantly being reactive. The fact of the matter is if we would have known about this, if we would have taken it out of our products decades ago, you would have protected an entire generation from this.
You've seen the documents. You saw how bad the documents were in the 1960s, 1970s. Monkeys were dying. All the monkeys were dying in the test. Beagles were dying. All the beagles were dying. Rats were dying. And as you know, I just took the deposition of the general counsel for 3M who is making this product. And so it's at what point do you say this wasn't a mistake? That there was some intent involved. Just talk about that just a little bit.
It absolutely wasn't a mistake. Like you said, 3M, the company that manufactures 90% of this chemical, has known for decades, since at least the 80s, that this is a biopersistent drug that is not going to leave the body anytime soon and that it's going to react with the body.
Okay, you've been asked, our firm's been asked to handle this case in Europe because we thought the PFAS was only a U.S. problem. But the truth is, it's in everybody's blood all over the planet right now. The government under Trump was trying to say, oh, well, you know, there's nothing we can do about it. So sorry. And at the same time, failing to say, oh, by the way, this causes cancer, birth defects, liver disease, hormone disruption, and it's in the environment for a million years. Give me your call on what this administration will do.
Well, I hope they do the right thing and they find ways to take it out. I mean, like you said, it's not going away anytime soon, but if we stop it in its tracks right now, we can protect generations to come. We can at least find solutions to get this out of the environment to some degree.
So as we look at it, it's something that regulatory oversight, what we're finding as we look at these documents, regulators were actually told, all these monkeys died. All of these beagles died when we did the experiment. We found out that the company, they held that back from the regulators. But then at some point, the regulators got it and still didn't do anything. So right now, it's in our drinking water. Matter of fact, right here in this town of Pensacola, it's in our drinking water. It's in the drinking water of most cities, urban cities throughout the United States. There's a way to solve that, isn't there?
Yeah, I mean, there's filters. There's an ability to take it out, but it just lands on the regulators and it lands on companies like 3M to do their job and fix this problem that they've caused.
Yeah, okay, so you've heard the term externalizing risk, right? Mm-hmm. So a company comes to town, they make the taxpayer take all the risk. They make the consumer takes all the risk, and 3M keeps all of the money. And that is the new way that businesses conduct themselves in the U.S. Let the taxpayers, let the consumers take all the risk. Isn't that kind of what we're seeing with this case?
Yeah, and I hope it changes relatively soon because that it's on 3M. They created this issue. They have to fix it.
Yeah, and they've got the money to do it. They just need to get busy. Sara, thank you for joining me, okay? That's all for tonight. Find us on Twitter and Facebook at facebook.com/RT America's Lawyer. You can watch all RT programs on DirecTV, channel 321. Also, stream them live on YouTube. And be sure to check out RT's new portable app where you can watch all your favorite shows. I'm Mike Papantonio, and this is America's Lawyer, where every week we tell you the stories that corporate media is ordered not to tell because their advertisers won't let them and because their political involvement doesn't allow for it. Have a great night.